Allow me to introduce you to the biggest rodent in the world, the capybara. It's sometimes known as the water pig because it can be found swimming, diving, or simply lounging in the waters throughout South America. And capybaras have also earned a reputation for being remarkably social animals. Not only do they live in large packs of their own kind, but they've also been known to allow other species to hitch a ride on their backs or even their heads, no questions asked. But while capybaras are interesting and indisputably cute, they're just one part of a lineage of rodents from South America with a long history of intrigue. These are known as the Caviomorpha. Caviomorpha originated in South America, and it's one of the most diverse groups of mammals in the whole Western Hemisphere. It contains roughly 250 species across 10 families, and includes some characters you might know, like guinea pigs, chinchillas, and porcupines. But here's the problem. The best evidence we have suggests that while Caviomorpha originated in South America, they came from ancestors in Africa over 40 million years ago. And even back then, Africa and South America were really far apart. So how did all of these famous and adorable rodents wind up where they are now? Well, the prevailing thinking is that Caviomorpha are a rare but not unheard of example of a group that got to where they are by just going with the flow. Caviomorphs, like our friend the capybara, belong to an infraorder of rodents known as Histricognathae, whose species are found in the Americas but also Africa and parts of Asia. And even though they're separated by an ocean, both the Old World and New World Histricognathes share some traits that show they're closely related. For one thing, they all have huge infraorbital foramina, which are openings on each side of the skull, just in front of the eyes. Part of the jaw muscle that these rodents use for chewing passes through this opening, which gives their molars extra strong bite force for grinding their food. And the teeth of Old and New World Histricognathes also share some similarities, which has helped scientists make the connection between the two groups. But the story of these rodents gets even more interesting when you look at some of their fossils. The earliest known caviomorph fossils in South America are 41 million years old, dating to the Middle Eocene epoch. They were discovered in the 2000s from a clay deposit in Peru, and right away, researchers knew there was something special about them. These fossil rodents were pretty small compared to later caviomorphs, around the size of voles or small rats. But they all share key traits in their teeth, traits that were also found among fossils of the Old World Histricognathes of about the same age. For example, their teeth all had low crowns and well-developed roots, as well as rounded cusps linked by ridges and upper molars that had five distinct ridges on them. Which is interesting, because again, the Peruvian fossils were found in a clay that was 41 million years old, which is a long time after South America and Africa separated during the breakup of the supercontinent Gondwana between 90 and 100 million years ago. What's more, the dates of these fossils have been corroborated by genetic evidence too. Using that method known as the molecular clock, scientists used well-dated fossils along with average mutation rates to estimate how long ago the New World Histricognathes diverged from the Old World ones. And the results came in at just about the same age as those Peruvian fossils, as early as 45 million years ago, again in the Middle Eocene. So caviomorphs must have originated in South America tens of millions of years after South America separated from Gondwana, which means that some Old World rodents must have migrated to South America by some route to give rise to the caviomorphs. The question is then, how? Well, a couple of hypotheses propose that the rodents actually originated from ancestors in Asia, and their descendants migrated through North America or Australia and Antarctica. But there's no fossil evidence of any likely caviomorph ancestors along either of these routes. So the prevailing theory these days? These animals arrived in South America from Africa by a transatlantic dispersal that involved riding on floating masses of plant debris. In other words, they rafted there. This hypothesis stems from the work of paleontologist René Lavoquet and taxonomist Robert Hofstetter, who published a series of studies on these rodents from 1969 to 1975. And they argued that an African origin for South America's Histricognathes was the best explanation for the similarities we see between Old and New World species today. And that, combined with the more recent fossil evidence, suggests that the South American lineage must have been founded by African rodents that traveled across the Atlantic, somehow. From there, the simplest and most logical explanation seemed to be that they just floated there. And decades of research into this idea has found that it's at least plausible. For one thing, around 40 million years ago, the distance between Africa and South America was a lot shorter than it is now, around 1,000 to 1,500 kilometers instead of 2,600 kilometers today. And the rodents may have been able to make stops along the way. There's evidence that back in the Middle Eocene, there may have been islands and shallow waters that span parts of the Atlantic. You can still see traces of this today on maps of the ocean floor, where two underwater ridges almost meet at the bottom of the Atlantic. Running east from South America, there's a ridge called the Rio Grande Rise, and drill samples from that ridge contain rocks that formed above water, as well as fossils of shallow water animals and red algae which need light to survive. Meanwhile, running west from Africa, there's the Walvis Ridge, and drilling there has revealed Middle Eocene volcanic rocks that were probably released above the ocean surface. So all of these findings point to there having been a strip of islands in shallow seas in the South Atlantic about 40 million years ago. But how would these little mammals have crossed the ocean, whether by island hopping or some other way? Well, there's no evidence of any actual raft, but it may have been a big mass of plant material, like branches and logs. That's partly because those sorts of materials would be buoyant enough to carry the animal's weight. But it's also supported by some modern, albeit very rare, observations of animals floating from place to place. For example, about a month after a hurricane struck the Caribbean in 1995, fishermen witnessed more than 15 green iguanas arriving on the shore of the island of Anguilla, where the iguanas had never been seen before. And the vessel these reptiles used was a mat of logs and trees more than 9 meters long in some places. Biologists believe that these iguanas floated hundreds of kilometers from their native populations on the island of Guadalupe to reach Anguilla. So it's at least possible. And as for how long this voyage might have taken for the ancient caviomorphs, one study actually did the math, using modern currents and wind velocities, to estimate that a transatlantic float could have taken 11 days if the journey took place 40 million years ago. Or if it happened 50 million years ago, when the continents were even closer, it might have been possible in as little as 8 days. Now, a week and a half on the open ocean with no fresh water would definitely have been unpleasant, but experts think that small mammals like the ancestors of the caviomorphs could have survived the journey. Now, the unlikely way in which these wayward rodents came to be where they are is an example of sweepstakes colonization, a concept originally proposed by paleontologist George Gaylord Simpson in 1940. Through this process, organisms cross through unsuitable territory to arrive in a new environment by chance. While uncommon, sweepstakes colonization is not completely unheard of. It's actually thought that the ancestors of the New World monkeys made an ocean voyage very similar to that of rodents around 10 million years later. And when the rodent colonists finally got to their new home, they had indeed hit the jackpot. Eocene South America had lots of resources for them, as well as new niches to fill, with few species to compete with. As a result, caviomorphs colonized the island continent and diversified rapidly, in a number of bursts between the Oligocene and Miocene. This is known as adaptive radiation, when a lineage of organisms undergoes an exceptionally high amount of diversification to fill a wide array of ecological niches. Descendants of these bursts of rodent diversification went on to fill all sorts of roles. Some wound up being semi-aquatic, like the capybara, but others became arboreal, like the spiny tree rat, and some even took to burrowing underground, like the cute little tuco-tuco. And they also covered an impressively broad range of sizes. The smallest members of the caviomorpha weigh between just 50 and 80 grams. But by 4 million years ago, South America was also home to the biggest rodent that ever lived, which was about the size of a horse. So caviomorphs seem to have an especially strange origin story. They exist because their ancestors defied the odds by surviving a voyage across the Atlantic Ocean. And when they arrived in their new world, the rodents rapidly diversified into the forms we know today, from the capybara to the guinea pig. And some members have migrated beyond South America, into the Caribbean and parts of North America. So rafting across the ocean on a mat of plants is by no means the preferred mode of migration for any terrestrial animal. But is it possible? The evidence in both fossil and modern caveomorphs says almost certainly. It just goes to show you that sometimes things we think are impossible turn out to be the best explanation. Thanks for joining me today, and a big thanks to our eontologists, Jake Hart, John Ivy, and of course, Steve. Now, what do you want to learn about? Leave me a comment and don't forget to go to youtube.com/eons and subscribe.